And I welcome you. I hope you've had a interesting and fun, exciting summer. If you wanted a calm, peaceful summer, I hope you had that as well. But I know that the AEOP Reset project is just a portion of what many of you have done this summer, and I really appreciate the time and effort that the level two members of our cohort, as they went to each of the Army education or the Army Research Laboratory sites and worked with their mentors this summer. In fact, we still have two who are on site up at the Picatinny location. So we'll be learning a lot from each other as we go through the next couple of weeks. And what I'm going to do now is share my computer screen. So for those of you who are online and able to look at the slide set, you'll be able to see that. Again, I'll be posting that electronically as well. Checking out who the full list of participants. I've got a screenshot that I'll be able to kind of see for kind of taking a role. So I'll be touching base with folks that didn't get a chance to join us live tonight. And some of you all know by phone number, and I'll be doing a little bit of matchup, but I may be reaching out to you just to confirm one-to-one if you have any questions after we go through the presentation.
I'm just joining. Is it too late?
Yeah, so if you're just joining by phone, if you're just joining by phone, I'll be saying everything that's on the slides. The slides are really just text. I don't have any images or anything very complicated. So I'll be saying it verbally, and you'll be able to see the slides later. I'll post them and make them available on the Google Classroom site, so you can pull those down and look at them as well. So if you're on phone, I also ask that you mute yourself. Background noise does kind of come through, and it will cause glitches for the rest of us who are listening. So if everybody can make sure you've muted yourself, but you are able to listen, that would be great. So what I'm pulling up now, for those of you who are on computer, and again, I will walk my way through this slowly, one by one, each point to talk about tonight. So this is module two of the AEOP reset work that we're doing together. So module one we did back during May, and it was called Introduction to Research. And module two is called Taking Research to the Classroom. So what we're going to do is first consider the outcomes. So we're going to look at where do we want to be at the end of our time together in module two. And here's the outcomes. What we are seeking as a cohort to create together are 7 lesson/unit plans. And the reason why I give ourselves freedom as a cohort to either focus on a lesson plan, something that could be accomplished in a shorter period of time in the classroom, versus a unit plan, which might be a collection of lessons, is each team is going to decide how best to convey the following. What we want to do, so it's okay if it ends up being a lesson plan, it's okay if it ends up being a unit plan. Either way, we want to make sure that they are completely expressed in a common format. And so what we're looking for is the ability to share these STEM lesson plans with other educators. So they don't have to be pristine. They don't have to be free of typographical errors or edits, but as much as possible, since we're working with teams and we'll have multiple eyes looking at these lesson plans, it would be great to kind of commit to some common structures. And so as a funded project with the Army, when I first pitched this idea that educators working at Army Research Labs is a great idea, but when they go to an Army research lab by themselves, they really don't have a network of other educators to support them. So what we designed into the RESET program was a level one and level two cohort mentality. And I said to the Army, it would be great if we used a common lesson structure. And I chose the legacy cycle format, which I introduced to you in Introduction to Research. And I think I justified it as something that made sense to me as an engineer. So it turns out the more that I hang out with educators, the more I realize that there are other frameworks and other structures for presenting lessons, especially in the science world. One of the very popular formats that is out there is 5E. And there's a lot of research around the 5E model. In fact, I've really read another research paper about 7E as a alternative or an update to 5E. But what I've decided with input from Tracy Davis and Phoebe Renee Lawing as your level three peer mentor educators this summer is that we really ought to give you the freedom as a team to decide, are you going to do legacy cycle or are you going to do a 5E structure? But it has to be one or the other. There's enough literature behind both of those that when we present lesson and or unit plans in those structures, other educators in the nation will be able to pick them up and find some comfort or familiarity with either one of those structures. And frankly, I expect 5E is more well known than legacy cycle. So I've decided to open up in this third year of our AEOP RESET work together, the idea that you as educators have some autonomy in deciding as a team when you're developing your lesson unit plan during module two that you can choose either structure. So that's going to be something that you need to decide fairly quickly as a team. The continued outcomes expectations of those lesson unit plans are that they are standards based. It would be fabulous, a luxury, if they were integrated STEM, if you were able to point to math standards and science standards, perhaps technology standards if those are appropriate for what your lesson would be used in which classrooms. But I fully understand that integrated STEM is really hard to pull off. So it's preferred, but it's not mandatory. But what is mandatory is that as a team, you focus on which of the standards, what grade levels does this particular lesson unit plan support. It could be that you decide as a team to offer multi-grade level versions of the same context or lesson. That's fine. You know, I would focus on getting it done for one grade level that makes sense for your team, and then say, here are some alternatives of how to modify the lesson plan to adapt to different grade levels. And that may be the way you take on infusion of math into something that's primarily a science lesson, or if it was a math lesson by design and you want to infuse it with science. Because each of us are from different states, the question will arise, what standards should we use? And as much as possible, I would encourage you to link to what you know about the next generation science standards or the Common Core math standards. But if I don't want this to be an obstacle to you, if it makes better sense for you to call out particular state numbered standards, just make sure we know what state it's pertinent in. And surely to goodness on the team, we can kind of make a cross-reference map about that particular standard and how it maybe connects to one of those national sets. That obviousness of the standards-based design of your lesson unit plan, that's something that your facilitators, myself and Tracy and Phoebe Renee, are going to be looking for. And we're going to keep pushing and prompting for that clear connection to standards-based design of your lesson plan. the other two expectations that come out of what those lesson plans need to clearly convey in a learning environment for students is a focus on research skills. So again, we're introducing students to research. And that takes on many different, as we've talked as a cohort, many of us have different understandings of how students learn how to research. But if we keep a focus on the research skills, and what I would ask you to really consider are the science and engineering practices that are expressed in the framework for K-12 science education. So that's a document independent of the NGSS, where you can really kind of go in and look at what's grade level appropriate for development of science and engineering practices. So your particular lesson unit plan may not support all of the science and engineering practices, but by calling out which ones they do, to me, that's going to be a very clear expression of what research skills are being supported in a student going through your lesson plan with the educator. The other focus that you need to have as you're writing these lesson unit plans is to keep a constant awareness about STEM careers and the connections that we would like students to be building an awareness of those STEM careers by considering the Army's science and engineering examples. For instance, those of you who were at a research lab site this summer as level two, you met a lot of scientists and engineers. They held certain types of jobs. Hopefully you were able to get some sense of background about those jobs. And it doesn't have to be overly specific, but what we want to make sure is that as a part of your lesson plan, students would be learning a more definitive link to possible STEM careers. And we're not trying to get everybody to join the Army, but we're basically saying, because this is Army funded and you were at Army research lab sites, it would be mighty cool if you highlight really great examples of science and engineering jobs that you saw in work, in practice at the Army locations. So this may actually include technical jobs, technician level training jobs, because I know many of the research labs have scientists, have engineers, have trained certified technicians. So that can be part of your lesson plan awareness, is that STEM career awareness. I just got a notice that my internet connection may be a little bit unstable. So hopefully the video is going to be capturing all this. In the event, as can happen, if we have bad weather and the internet connection goes down, I will re-record this presentation and make sure that you have it available. So as I'm talking, please be writing any questions that you have, because when I get done, we will have a Q&A session and I'll be able to kind of have you unmute one by one to make sure if you've got any questions. So just as a quick recap, Module 2 outcomes, we are expecting 7 lesson/unit plans total from the cohort. We have 5 teams, and I'll explain how 5 becomes 7 in just a moment. Those lesson unit plans are STEM lesson plans that can be shared with other educators. They're using either the legacy cycle or a 5E structure to support project-based learning. They are standards-based. They focus on research skills, considering the science and engineering practices. They focus on STEM career awareness by considering the Army's science and engineering personnel examples from the sites that the Level 2 visited this summer. We will, as a cohort, have a go public. Now, it's a go public just for us. So that's the big other outcome of Module 2. We will be sharing amongst ourselves a go public opportunity where you present your lesson plan as a team, and that is scheduled for September 10th. That's the 28th day of Module 2. Each team will be presenting their lesson plan. We'll use Zoom. It'll be recorded. I'll probably do it in segments of recordings, so I don't have to edit the recording. I'll have Team 1, Team 2, or Team Medina, Team Gust, you know, we broke it up by the mentor's team name. So always looking at what the destination is, 28 days from now, we're going to have a Go Public event just for us, and we're going to be able to tell a short story about our lesson plan, 10 minutes. So you need to be thinking, even while you're developing that lesson plan, how can I tell my story about the lesson plan in 10 minutes? That'll be the challenge to Go Public. All right, moving on to the next slide. I mentioned teams. So in module two, we're forming up, and in fact, we already did this a little bit during the summer. I didn't push on you very much to connect to your teams, but now's the time for you to make sure you know which team you're on and who you should be working with. So we have five teams named after the five mentors that we had in the Reset Cohort 2018. We have Team Guy, and the nickname for that might be Obi's team. So Obi worked with Dr. Guy. Phoebe Renee Lawing is going to be the facilitator for that team. Team Guy is responsible for one lesson slash unit plan. And right now, I'm not really sure what their topical focus might be. That's going to be based on Obi's experiences at the site that he was at this summer. So Team Guy will be meeting up and talking about and finalizing in the next week what kind of their topic choices might be for that lesson plan. They'll be thinking, are they going to use 5E? Are they going to use Legacy Cycle? And Phoebe Renee Lawing is going to be facilitating that process with Team Guy. Team Medina is the other team that Phoebe is going to be facilitating, and that's nicknamed Alicia's team because Alicia worked with Dr. Medina. They're also as a team responsible for one lesson unit plan. And again, I'm not quite sure. I was looking through my emails trying to find and glean input. You may have already told me what the topic is, but within the next week, your team will be finalizing topic focus. Team Medina will be thinking, are we using 5E or Legacy Cycle? And then they're going to be maybe picking who's going to work on what. Each team is going to be responsible for deciding how that lesson plan gets fleshed out. Team Suarez is Nelia's team. She worked with Dr. Suarez, and Tracy Davis is going to be the facilitator for Team Suarez. They're responsible for one lesson unit plan. Again, it can be a lesson, or if it is by nature more what you would consider a unit, that's fine. There's no expectations here around lesson versus unit. They'll be finalizing their topic structure this week. They'll be thinking about 5E or Legacy Cycle format. Team Gust is the first example of a team that's responsible for two lesson or unit plans because Dr. Gust worked with both Kelda and Linda. And I think from some of the conversation that I had with Tracy and Phoebe, Kelda and Linda's groups may have already started kind of focusing in on certain topics. And if not, again, nobody's locked into topics yet, but they do need to be inspired by the site location that Kelda and Linda were at. Working with Dr. Gust, I expect that the two project areas that they worked in, even though they were working with the same mentor, were very different in terms of focus. So we would maybe expect then two distinct lesson opportunities coming out of that setting. In the same way, the fifth team working with Dr. DeBeery, Don and Angela are there now. And that one, as far as I know, is still focusing on 3D printing. I'm gonna be the facilitator for that one, but because we had two level two folks there, we'll also be generating two distinct lesson and or unit plans. So those are the teams, five teams, because we had five mentors and it was easy to name the teams after the mentor name. We have for your planning as an individual, so each of us is in this cohort together with cohort expectations, cohort outcomes, team outcomes, but you as an individual need to be aware that the grant supports 20 hours of your time over the next 28 days. I just saw a typo. It says, be sure to keep your time log, but your time log, so I'll fix that. What I did in the past was we actually had So this is just a history piece for you. You can provide me feedback as a cohort member about what's working and what's not working for you so that we can improve this learning experience in the future. In the past, we put 30 hours of effort in module one and 30 hours of effort in module two. What I did this summer was to put 20 with module one, 20 that your team could be using over the summer to communicate with one another, and then 20 in module two. I didn't clearly convey to you how that 20 hours should work during the middle of summer, and I'm sorry for that. If you have felt like you didn't, as a level one, do any of that 20 hours during the middle part of summer, it's okay. I've gone ahead and paid you with the full expectation that now you've got extra time that you can put towards this module two. What I need for you to do is document your time for module two as a minimum 20 hours over 28 days. So I know it's busy time of year. Everybody's getting back in classes if you're not already in the classroom, but I'm hoping that this is an expectation that will work for you. In the worst case scenario, and you say, there's no way I can do 20 hours, please convey that to me and we'll talk about alternatives. We'll kind of explore what's making it difficult for you to do that 20 hours with your team. But I really think, I'm hoping that this fits your life schedule over the next month. So tonight, for example, you get to claim 1 hour. Log it on a time log. We're here all together doing a Zoom kickoff meeting. I'm hosting it on Monday, August 13th. If you're not able to be online tonight and you're watching this video after the fact that you've viewed the video, you've thought about the video, you took notes, you perhaps emailed me with questions, that I think and could still count as an hour if you're doing it as a makeup. I've worked with Tracy and Phoebe, Renee, to kind of come up with an idea of how we can facilitate your work as teams. And I suggested that, and I'm requiring that we have what I call touch points. So as a team, you will get together online with your facilitator. I'm going to show you on the next screen how that might work. You can use this Zoom room. If you've noticed, the number's always the same. It's my virtual meeting room. So we've got a schedule where you can have a 30-minute touch point with your facilitator live, try to get all your team members at the same time, having a touch point once a week. So that touch point would happen on August 20th. That touch point would happen on August 27th. On September 3rd, that's Labor Day, so there just needs to be a touch point sometime during that week. I figure Labor Day, you're with family, it's a vacation, you're not going to be getting online. But you'll have a couple of weeks to figure out how you're going to handle that September 3rd meeting. And then September 10th, we all come back together again in the same Zoom room and we host our Go Public, where I turn over control to a representative from each team who's going to present the lesson plan. I am okay if a team has 3 or 4 people who want to co-present, but remember, you only have 10 minutes. So if you're thinking about creating a presentation about your lesson plan to explain how it works, to show us the resources that you pulled together, to kind of walk us through a 10-minute example of how that lesson plan would play out in the classroom, I'm okay if your team decides to make a video about it. And that way your team could work together to, hey, you make 2.5 minutes, I make 2.5 minutes, somebody's a mad, crazy video editor, and they put together a 10-minute video that explains your lesson plan. That would be fabulous, but I'm not expecting it. But I'm offering, if that's a skill set within your team and you want to make a video because you want everybody to equally present, that would be one way to do it. When we're in the Zoom, and I'll be asking who's going to be the main presenter for each team, it does not have to be the level two educator. It could be one of the level ones who's very passionate about explaining the lesson plan that your team came up with. So that's a team decision, who's going to be the spokesperson, or if you're going to try to put together a video to show. But on that September 10th day that we will not have time, I'm going to try to hold it to 1.5 hours. We won't have time for everybody to constantly change. It's just too much transition time within a 10-minute block. So be thinking about how you want that go public to work on behalf of your team. I love the idea of a video, but I'm not expecting it this year. Maybe cohort 2019, that might be an expectation. So module two, you're going to log 20 hours. You're probably going to, maybe some of you might end up doing more than 20 hours. That's okay, because maybe you didn't quite get 20 hours done during the middle of summer. But I do need that time log for module two. So go ahead and start it today. Keep it as a Google Doc, something that you can share with me later. Keep it as a Word doc, something that you can scan and send to me. Totally up to you how you keep your time log. Next slide says module two, touch points times three. So this is the way it can work. You can use this Zoom room, and what we're going to have automatically set aside on Monday nights from on Eastern time, from 7 to 7:30, there's a block of time with logging. There's a second block of time from 7:30 to 8 on Eastern time. Now, Phoebe, Renee, I fully expect your two teams, and your two teams are Team Guy and Team Medina. One of the decisions you'll need to make this very first week is which team, Medina or Guy, is going to be online at 7, and which team is going to be online at 7:30. So Phoebe and Renee is on the Eastern Coast, so she's on Eastern time. That would be 6 o'clock Central time, 5 o'clock Mountain time, and am I doing this right? 4 o'clock, we can check my math. That would be 4 o'clock Pacific time. So if that becomes an issue, we can work it out. My point is we're going to make the room open during that half-hour time block for you to do your touch point with your teams. But I expect there's going to be some email, making sure everybody's on board with this, which team is going to meet at which time. Phoebe and Renee is going to convey that to me. I'm going to set out a Zoom invite so it's on everybody's calendar, you know, so that we're going to try to facilitate as much as possible to remind you when you need to be online. Tracy Davis will be facilitating two teams, also on Monday nights. And her times are 7 to 7:30 Central time, which would now become 8 to 8:30 Eastern time, and we can play with the time zones. And then she would also have 7:30 to 8 on Central time. So those are the touch point times in the Zoom room. It's Monday, August 20th, Monday, August 27th. And then you have to figure out as a team when you want to try to do the touch point during the week of Labor Day. So three touch points between now and the go public on September 10th. My team that I'm facilitating, Team DeBerry, we will decide via email if a Tuesday night works. Or if you're really like late night owls, like I am, we could do the Monday night Central time 8 to 8:30, 8:30 to 9. But I'll be in touch with DeBerry to Team DeBerry to figure that out. All right. Take a deep breath. I know I'm pushing a lot of information out. Module 2, resources. So things to help you in your lesson plan work. I will be posting resources into the Module 2 Google Classroom. Postings will be within this week. And also, I expect many of you are like me, you collect information, you may have great resources to share. So once you see what I've posted, if you're wanting to go ahead as a cohort and make things available to one another, just respond to the posting in the Google Classroom, send me an email with a link to what it is you want to share, I can post it. But we will make sure that we're using the Google Classroom to keep all of our postings to support writing of lesson plans in Module 2. For example, I'll be posting some sample legacy cycles. I will be posting tools that would help you create, for example, challenge questions or scenarios. That's stage one of a legacy cycle. I'll be sharing with you examples of different styles of go publics that you might not have thought about. I'll be sharing with you some tools that can help lay out the lesson structure, offering alternatives or suggestions for what you might think about for multiple perspectives, which is a great place to bring in that STEM career awareness. Things that you can do to maybe think about formative assessments that are embedded during the legacy cycle stage of test your mettle. And so I'll be focusing on helping post resources around legacy cycles. Phoebe Renee shared a really great resource about 5E, and we'll get that up and posted. And I'm sure many of you may have other examples of the 5E lesson structure that you would like to share. Please do so. Again, you can always respond directly in the Google Classroom. You can respond to announcements, or I'm not going to make assignments in Module 2 like I did in Module 1. I'm only going to make postings of announcements, and then you can respond to that. And in those announcements, you'll see various links to those resources. One of the resources to help us convey our work to one another that I'm going to set up tonight and test tomorrow with making sure that Tracy and Phoebe Renee have a chance to double check the way I've set it up. We're going to have folders for each team on the shared Google Drive that I share the links for each team within the Google Classroom, so you know exactly what folder you should be working in as a team. So those links for each team will be made and posted this week. I really want each team to share their work in progress. So when you're having a touch point meeting with your facilitator, there needs to be materials findable in that folder as an example of the progress that your team is making. So the kinds of things that you could be having there would be a shared Google Doc that you are co-editing together as a team that have the sections for either the legacy cycle or the sections for the 5E lesson structure. You will need to make sure that you post in that same team folder a very clearly marked final version of your lesson plan by Sunday, September 9th, in advance of our go public. One of the things that Tracy and Phoebe Renee can talk about as past cohort members, and I think any of us as creative educators, lesson plans often stay in a somewhat of a draft format, unless we're really focusing on sharing it with somebody else. So I could show you a lesson plan where I know I could address 5 or 6 days worth of activities in one of my college classes, and I could convey it in one page to myself because I have all of the in-between steps built into the way that I do things. So I would only call that kind of like a cheat sheet version of a lesson plan. So that would not be helpful to any other educator because they couldn't read my mind. So the idea of having you work in teams is you're constantly checking one another. What have we assumed? What have we made explicit in our lesson plan versus implicit? So this team structure is meant to help us create a stronger lesson plan that becomes more ready for dissemination. Now that said, some of you may have experience with writing and or reviewing rigorously developed lesson plans, you know, things that go under review, for example, by NSTA. There are a group of educators who curate really exemplary lesson plans. You can find those in the NSTA resources. We're not there yet. I don't expect with 20 hours of effort, even from 4 to 5 educators working together in the same team, that we would be creating that level of curation of reviewed lessons. But I want you to kind of find a happy middle, somewhere between that sketchy one-page description and that very detailed exemplars that each of us might have found from our professional education societies. Some of the lesson plans that I see from NCTM, for example, are really lovely, but the level of development time may be beyond what your team has. What we should have is something that I think that you would feel confident giving to a peer and they could put to work in their classroom. So I encourage you as a team, you're going to be having work review by your facilitator, but also use your peers. Say, here's a new idea that we're using and we're developing this lesson plan and I just want to kind of give it to you to have you read through it and offer me suggestions for improving it. So over the next 28 days, if you can think about how you can have something that you would feel proud to hand off to one of your fellow educators and feel confident that there would be enough detail for them to be able to make some use of that lesson plan in their own classroom. That's what we're going for. That would be what I would consider your final version posted by Sunday, September 9th. So that's it for the presentation for I have tonight. What I'd like to do is get out of presentation mode so I can get back to seeing you and take any questions, because that was a lot of information for a kickoff meeting. I'm going to put you in grid, and then I'm going to either call you out by phone number just to verify once we start the Q&A session, and or I'm going to look for people waving their hand with a, hey, I've got a question, and then I'll invite you to take yourself off of mute and ask your question, and I'll do my best to answer. So the people that I have on video, we'll start with you. I'll just start querying from left to right. I've got everybody in a cute little camera grid. Angela, do you have any questions? Don't forget to take yourself off mute.
There we go. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay, great. Hi, everyone. So my first question is it 10 minutes per lesson plan? Because we have two for our group.
Yes. It is 10 minutes per lesson plan, so that would be 70 minutes, and then what we'll do is we'll hold all Q&A for the lesson plan presentations to the end.
Okay, great. And so there's no actual template for the lesson plans other than using the 5E structure or the legacy cycle, is that right?
That's correct. Okay. The reason is I didn't want you to get overly focused on having to fit a template. Sometimes I know when I've received templates, I end up fighting the template all the time. So I just want you to focus on the content of those sections, and we'll share some example templates. So I don't want you to feel like you have to create your own, but I'm not requiring that you use those specific templates.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Alicia, do you have any questions? Let me see if I can there you go. I got you unmuted, Alicia.
Okay, so I guess my question is, I had a couple of things in mind as my topic.
Yep.
We did a lot of pH testing and sample collection. And I was thinking along those lines. But we also like really stress lab safety. So I guess I'm trying to figure out what I think would be a good lesson to you. Yeah. Would any of those be options?
Yep. And I think that's where brainstorming time with your team and your facilitator would be fantastic, because there may be some creative ways to combine the two.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
That's it.
Awesome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Mylene? Let's see if I can unmute you. Well, we froze up.
Hello.
There you go. We're good. We can hear you.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, I'm sorry I was like half an hour late, but
Actually, I had a question because we are trying to do like one level, that's like lower level lesson plan, but I'm also doing one for high school.
Oh, good. Yeah, that's quite fine. We had some teams do
more
that.
More than one lesson plan? Okay, because yeah, and I agree with them. We are doing like the for like elementary and middle school, but since I work in high school and the project is so good, I'm trying to fit something for my chemistry class. So I'm gonna see it. Just I don't want to step on something that's not possible. But since now we're gonna share in Google Classroom, will be easy.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that that's a great idea to maybe take the same context, but say, what does it look like at an elementary middle school level, and what could I do with it uniquely different at a high school level? So yeah, I look forward to, and if you've got questions, and that's why we really want
okay.
to see work in progress, because the more we share with your facilitator, the more feedback and ideas that can kind of come together. And so that's why I wanted to see your work in progress inside those folders and not just wait till the final product's ready.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Yeah, I think it'll be easy, yes.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay.
Jody? Okay, Jody, I unmuted you. So do you have any questions?
No, I don't. Well, okay. No, I really don't. Our team has been in communication already, so we're kind of wrapping our heads around it all. So.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you. All right. So I have a iPhone identified that I'm going to unmute, and then you can tell us who you are.
I'm Adrian.
Okay. Great, Adrian.
Hi.
Yes, I don't have any questions.
Okay, so you're okay for now? All right, great, thank you. And Amber, I'm gonna unmute you and see if you have any questions.
I don't have any questions.
Okay, all right, thank you, Amber.
Hello?
Hi.
It's Obi.
Oh, hey, Obi.
Hi.
So do you have any questions?
I have no questions.
Nope?
Nope. Okay. Pretty straightforward.
Okay. All right. Very good. Thank you.
No problem.
Linda, I'm going to unmute you.
Hi. No questions.
Okay.
Oh, I guess fine. Never mind. Change my mind. So it says that the topic I have is on biotech. I'm going to lean towards more environmental toxicology.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so I will change that. Thank you in my slides. Environmental toxicology. Tracy, you can help me remember that, please. Thanks, Linda.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
Kelda?
Yes, I'm here.
All right, do you have any questions?
I do not. I'm going to focus on the STEM careers and give some different scenarios where they can, where the students can research and kind of design their team, and then they'll go into designing their experiment.
And oh, great. Sounds good. Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Aziz?
I think I'm good, thank you.
Okay, all right. Dawn?
Hi, Angela asked our question. Hi, Angela asked the questions before. I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Great. Thank you. I have, and it may be, I'm trying to figure out, I'm going to unmute you and then see if you have questions. Let's see. All right. So it's only identified as iPhone on my screen. It's not a telephone number, it's just identified as iPhone.
Is it
It's Phoebe.
It's Phoebe. Okay, you're good. You don't have any questions. All right, and now I've got a phone number, 956 319-8116.
Hello, that would be me.
Okay, do you have any questions?
Well, no, I guess just to recap, then the lesson plan would be on any grade level from K to 12, correct?
Yeah.
So as a team, we would just choose any one grade level, and then the lesson plan could be as easy as a one-page lesson plan with the, for example, following the 5E.
No, I want it extended beyond one page.
Okay. Is there like a specific limit since we're doing two, or?
I think that's a great question for your facilitator to respond to. So I think that's something to kind of flesh out during week one or okay. Sorry, this week while you're working together as a team. I know that, and remember, we're really trying to focus on project-based learning. So even though 5E can be conveyed in a very short format, there's usually a lot of resources to kind of help go along with a 5E. So you would want to be as explicit as possible about how those resources would be used within student-centered project-based learning using the 5E structure.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. All right, I've got 201-424-7507.
Sally, that's Dawn again. I had computer trouble, so I'm listening on my phone and watching on my computer.
Oh, sweet. We got you here twice. That's awesome. Thanks, Dawn.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I've got 678-378-4410.
Hi, this is Casey. I don't think I have any questions right now, but thank you, though.
Okay, thanks, Casey. And the last one that I'm showing is 662-392-2. Okay.
No question.
No questions. All right. Well, I'm excited. I'm going to be touching base with Angela and Dawn because I want to know a lot more about what's going on in their life. I really encourage you to use email as your teams. I hope that you don't think I'm overly intrusive and that your facilitators are overly intrusive over the next 28 days, but I'm making up for going offline with you all as a cohort in June and July by paying a lot more attention to you in August, because I'm excited about revisiting the two prior year cohorts and pulling the best of examples as legacy cycles together over the next week to share with you out of those prior cohorts so that you get a sense for what your target could be. I'm going to be sharing with you a publication from one of the NSTA journals that it showed where a middle school science educator had done research around the use of legacy cycle in their classroom. And I really think that I'll be learning a lot more about 5E, and I'll be very curious about how we can kind of look at, maybe even Tracy and I and Phoebe have talked about taking a lesson that is in 5E structure and presenting it as legacy cycle and vice versa. Because sometimes I think we need flexibility in our tools in the classroom, and there are benefits to both structures. There's one last piece of good news for you. As a cohort, obviously you do receive stipend for this work together that you're doing, the 20 hours. We went ahead and asked the university to cut checks for the 20 hours that would have been your communication time with each other during the summer. So if you received that and you wondered why you got it, it was because we hoped that you would be able to get a jump start on some of this work together as a team. If you haven't, as a team member, been able to feel like you've contributed much yet, that's okay. You will. That's the beauty of teamwork. We kind of do what we have to do to meet the goal. I do have a set of funds within the grant that we are referring to as a mini grant. that each of you as cohort members can apply for individually to have purchased on your behalf some materials to help support your implementation of your legacy cycle or 5E lesson in your classroom. So yes, you're on a team that may end up be writing a middle school or a high school level focused lesson plan, and let's say it's the wrong grade level for you. Hopefully you can see your way clear to use a variation of that same lesson structure. And then you would say, in order for me to put that to work in my classroom, it would be really handy to have this resource. Maybe it's an accelerometer or a data acquisition system or a pH sensing kit for my class. Or you're going to tell me what makes sense to support your lesson plan. And I'm going to be using a short form for you to apply for that mini grant. And I'm looking at different price ranges for that mini grant. It would be anywhere from $500 to $750 worth of resources for your particular classroom in order for you to implement that lesson plan. So be thinking about that. The reason why I can't just write you a check for that money is because of the way the grant was structured. I will have to purchase those materials on your behalf and then send them to you. So I will probably, in order to facilitate the time that it takes for me to get things ordered and to turn it around before the end of this grant cycle, which is September 30, I will need to kind of specify a few particular vendors that I will encourage you to look at first, because as a university, we have pre-existing vendor contract agreements and it makes life much easier for me. So for example, if it's a Vernier data acquisition device or a Pasco unit or something out of, there's a couple of different science instructional, maybe it's Frey. There's a couple of different catalogs that are pretty standard for science instruction. So I'll be putting that information together by the end of this week. And then you'll have 2 to 3 weeks to figure out. I'll put a deadline probably towards the end of August for you to turn in your request via a Google form. I'll send you the link. You'll put in your information. I know that your lesson plans won't be in their final version, but you can refer to your lesson plan by whatever status it's at and make your justification for why you need those resources. And you don't have to feel like you have to ask for the full amount, but for your budgetary planning, it'll be either $500 or $750, depending on the answer I get from the Army as to whether or not I can budget for more. So be thinking around that $500 mark, maybe be ready to ask for $750 if it makes sense. And I hope that that's something that will be useful for your classrooms. But any information that you need about that will be coming via email when I explain how the application process works for that mini grant. All right, well, we're right at 8 o'clock and I look forward to working with you over the next couple of weeks. I'm really looking forward to your Go Publics and I hope you have a beautiful rest of the evening and a great week. So we'll wrap it up here and good night.
Dr. Pardee.
Yes, ma'am.
I have a question right quick when everybody logs off.
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. We'll wait for everybody to log off, Tracy, okay. And then you and I can stay on. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.